Good morning. Thank you for choosing to worship with us this morning. Please take out your bulletins and look it over for a moment or so. The first thing I'll bring to your attention, though, is not the bulletin, but the newsletter. We have a few copies in the back, and I have emailed out to the whole congregation. If you did not receive one of these in email, that means I do not have your email. So if you would like to get one, please give me your email after church, and I will send one to you out Monday when I come in to the office. There's a couple of articles in here I do want to bring to your attention. There's like 2 pages of vacation Bible school pictures, really cool stuff. You can see all that we did for that whole week. And God was really with us. We weren't even sure if we were going to be able to have VBS or not this year, but God blessed our efforts. And these pictures are a good representation of what's going on here. My favorite 2 pictures are the ones on this page. You got Mondo there with his water gun. And I'm saying Mondo is having too much fun. And the next one is a picture of me trying to get up off the ground. I'm just too old for this stuff. That's what it looks like anyway. But the main thing I'll bring to your attention is an article called A New Normal in Communion. I understand there's a little bit of confusion. We did communion last week. We didn't understand how the cups and the wafer and all that worked. So I got some nice pictures here, and I give you some instructions on how this is supposed to work. So look that over, and if you still have any questions about how we're going to be doing communion, at least for a while, let me know, and I'll try to clear it up for you, okay? I'm sorry if there's any misunderstanding last week. We didn't want to cause any confusion in what we're trying to do. Anyway, so these are available in the back if you didn't get one yet. Please take a moment to fill out your connection cards if you're a visitor with us, so we have a record of your attendance and how to get a hold of you. CPR class is this Wednesday, and there are still some seats. If anybody would like to be, it's a 2-year certification for first aid and CPR, so it's really well done. It's 2-year certification, and the cost is $85. Talk to Brad or talk to Matt in the back afterwards, and then we need to get our final numbers in so we know how many we're going to have. And also, don't forget to pick up the latest magazines in the back. The new Acts and Facts is now available. Are there any announcements that I have not made before we continue? Great. Matthew 21:9. This takes place with what we call the triumphant entry. Jesus is coming in to Jerusalem on the colt. And this is what it says. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." Hosanna, Hosanna. We sang that in our opening song. According to Google, Hosanna means save, I pray. I like that. When you're shouting to Jesus, you're saying, save, I pray. Save, I pray. I like that. I've always liked the song because I can't think of a better song for a call to worship. Praise is rising. Eyes are turning to you. That's to God. So the question is, are they? Hope is stirring. Hearts are yearning for God. Again, are they? It's important when we enter into worship that we are prepared to focus on God. Our hearts and our minds need to be open to God. Before each service, Mondo and the praise team, we go in the back and we pray to get ourselves focused. And it really, really helps. Gets rid of our outside distractions, all the busyness. We just ask the Lord to fill us with his spirit and allow us to worship through what we're doing. In the congregation, when you come in, you can do the same thing. Take a moment as you sit in your seat. Just relax, take a deep breath, pray to the Lord. Allow him to clear your mind, clear your heart, so you have room for him to enter in as you worship. Ask him to fill you with his spirit. So let us pray together. We're going to do that. Hosanna, Hosanna. Lord, you are the God who saves us. You are indeed worthy of all of our praises. As we enter into this time of worship, allow us to be grateful for our salvation and for all that you have been doing for us and done for us. Let us be prepared to worship the one who saved us. Fill us with your spirit, O Lord. When we sing, let us sing from our hearts. And when we pray, allow us to pray from our hearts as well. We pray that each one of us, Lord, would be refreshed and renewed and filled with the Spirit as we leave this place. Let the people know that we have worshiped the one true God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
You guys will stand. We'll continue with our worship.
We are slowly getting back to normal with things at our church. We're still not passing things around, so still not passing the offering bags. I look forward to the day that we do. That kind of means that this whole thing will be over finally. So that's going to be a great day, isn't it? We just pray for God. God is going to do wonders. He can do miracles. He can just lift this whole pandemic thing from us like nothing. So it's all up to Him. Let's pray together, please, for our offering. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. You are the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. You are indeed worthy of all of our praises. We have worshipped you through song, and now it is our desire to worship you by dedicating our tithes and our offerings. We thank you, O Lord, for the gifts that were received and for those that will be received. Grant us wisdom in the use of the gifts. May we be good stewards with that which was given. We ask you to bless each gift and bless each giver. In Jesus' name, amen.
Have a problem standing up the last couple weeks. All right, we're going to have the kids head to the back with their teachers. If they would like to. The rest of us, if you have your Bibles, turn with me to the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 4. And as always, there are people that are new this morning or visiting. We want to welcome you for sure. And we have been progressing through the book of Galatians and talking about the nature of the gospel and the essential nature of the gospel, the importance of the gospel, in that as we go and we preach and we stand strong and united, we know that Jesus plus nothing is the gospel. And so that's kind of been the fight that Paul has been waging in the book of Galatians, enough that in chapter 1, he describes anybody that would come along and preach a different gospel, one that would say Jesus plus something else, they are to be cursed forever, eternal damnation. I mean, pretty serious charge. Paul very rarely does that. And here, he has gone and preached the good news to the Galatians, and after he left, a group known as the Judaizers came along and encouraged them, Jesus is great. Jesus is great. We love Jesus. He's awesome. He died on the cross. We love that. But in order to really see, to really receive God's approval, we just need to add a few things. And Paul has been fighting that battle. And so one of the things that I thought would be appropriate is to take a step back a little bit from the book of Galatians for a moment in this regard. Because Paul has been preaching pretty hard against this idea of adding something to the gospel, and primarily it's been the Mosaic Law. That has been the discussion, is, you need to follow this commandment or this commandment in order to add something. But as we saw last time, there's this impression that we might have that the law is bad, that the Mosaic Law in the Old Testament was something that was a hindrance. And what we want to do today is we want to step back and not be too extreme to say that if you decide to, let's say, not eat pork, we know in the Old Testament, Leviticus 11, you know, you're not allowed to eat pork or bacon, shrimp, sorry, all that's out. But what if somebody today, as a New Testament Christian, wants to not eat pork? Do we come down and say, you're just a legalist, you're just trying to follow the Old Testament, and so we can come and we can be extreme and to minimize or to judge them or to be condescending or show with them some contempt? And Paul would say, whoa. Just because someone desires to follow something doesn't mean, especially if they're not adding it to the gospel, who are you to judge them in that regard? So what we're going to talk about today is freedom, the freedom in Christ. So as a Christian, there are certain things in the Bible that, for example, what Paul does in the Romans 14 passage, which we're going to go to, he brings up this idea of celebrating certain days, like a Sabbath day, okay? He also brings up drinking wine. He also brings up eating meat or eating vegetables. And so is there any commandment that you could pull out of the New Testament that says, thou shalt not have a glass of wine? You can look. It's not in there. Does it say, thou shalt not get drunk? Yes. Okay, it does say that. So what Paul begins to do, is especially in the book of Romans, is he says, let's talk about these areas that are gray areas, that are matters and differences of opinion. But what I want to do is start out with in 1 Corinthians 4, because this is really important, because within humanity, we all have different opinions, right? And sometimes we hold to them very passionately, and it's easy for us at times to convince ourselves that our way is the right way. And pride sneaks in. And then we begin to say, well, if they were as righteous as I am, or if they were as good as I am, they would see it my way. And what Paul wants to remind us as Christians is that humility is one of the best virtues of what it means to be a Christian. And to the Corinthians were probably one of the worst churches. I mean, they're God's people, they're saved, they're going to heaven, they love Jesus, but they were extremely immature in their spirituality. They had issues of division, they had issues of pride, they went around parading, well, my gift is better than your gift. Can you imagine that? My spiritual gift is better than your gift. And Paul had to write to them about the basic elements of what love looks like, because they were forgetting that. I mean, the greatest chapter of love we know in the Bible is 1 Corinthians 13. It's read at weddings often, which is good, but it kind of misses the point in that 1 Corinthians 13 is one of the highest levels of what it means to be a Christian, is mean to be loving. And so he's writing to them in 1 Corinthians 4 here, and he's reminding them that they are not allowed to judge somebody else's heart or their motives. So chapter 4, verse 1, as a background here, he says, let a man so consider us as servants of Christ, slaves, and stewards of the mysteries of God. Moreover, it is required in stewards or managers that one be found faithful. But with me, it is a very small thing that I should be judged by you or by a human court. So what he says here right at the beginning is, hey, I'm to be faithful in what I'm supposed to be doing and living for God and that sort of thing. But you know what? You are not my Lord. You're not my master. I'm not going to allow myself to be judged by you, because you don't know all things. You don't know my heart. God does. And I'll give you an example of what that means. He says, in fact, I do not even judge myself, for I know of nothing against myself, yet I am not justified by this, but he who judges me is the Lord. What he's saying there is, if you go help somebody, let's say you go help somebody cross the street, or you give money to someone who is in need, why did you do it? Paul says, sometimes I don't even know why I did it. Maybe I did it to make myself feel better about myself. Maybe I did it because I wanted to look good in front of somebody. Maybe I did it truly because I wanted to do it for the Lord, and it was a completely self-sacrificial act. He says, man, I don't even know what my own motives are. So if that's true about me, do you know what my motives are? He says, the only one that knows my motives, not even me, is the Lord. He says in verse 5, therefore judge nothing before the time until the Lord comes, who will both bring to light the hidden things of darkness and reveal the motives of the heart. Then each one's praise will come from God. So he says, hold off on thinking that you have the insight into somebody else's behavior. Now these things, brethren, I have figuratively transferred to myself and Apollos for your sakes, for your understanding. Now this here's the principle, that you may learn in us this principle. Not to think beyond what is written, that none of you may be puffed up on behalf of one against another. For who makes you different from one another? And what do you have that you did not receive? And if you did indeed receive it, why do you brag as though you had not? The principle here, you can go with me to Romans chapter 14 now, back one book. This is super important for us as we think about gray areas. Again, when you look at Scripture, the Bible talks very clearly, don't steal, don't commit adultery, don't lie. Those are clear things, right? We understand. Yeah, that's clear. But when we think about other things that are not clear, the principle that you have here is, do not go beyond what is written. And so I encourage everybody, myself included, if I say something to you, you're going to go, do you have a verse on that? What verse do you have to back it up? Because for me, I can stand up here and give you my opinion all day, and you'd be like, Mondo, we didn't come to church to hear your opinion. We came to hear God's word, because this has authority. My opinion does not. And so it's important to say, if you're going to ask me to do something or not do something, show me the verse. Follow this scriptural pattern. Do not think and go beyond what is written. And as soon as I start venturing in and start telling you things that bind you, potentially, you know, thou shalt not cross the street on Mondays, you're going to go, well, Mondo, we appreciate that opinion of yours, but do you have a verse on that? No? Well, thank you, and have a nice day, but no thanks, okay? You're free to have your opinion, but we're not going to follow it, okay? Just so remember this principle. So what we're going to see today in Romans 14 is these principles that Paul has. So let's just jump in. I just want to go through this because what I'm seeing in the church, and this is all over the place. So the title is, To Mask or Not to Mask? This 4x6 inch piece of cloth, fabric, whatever, is wreaking havoc in the church. It's amazing that you have accusations or judgments being cast from this side on the mask wearers, and the non-mask wearers are saying, well, this. And so you think, really? Satan is just going, this is great. These guys, they're tearing each other up. Now, can anybody give me a verse that says, thou shalt wear a mask? It's not there. So what it does then is it reduces us down to the next level of understanding, which is a secondary issue. It's a gray area. It's something that we need to have wisdom on, and we pray about, and we seek. That's what Paul is dealing with here. And ultimately what it means is it's a matter of opinion. So chapter 14, verse 1, this is the law of liberty, or the principles of freedom, of liberty. He says, receive one who is weak in the faith, but do not argue over opinions, differing opinions. What he's saying here is, he's going to use this language about weak and strong in the faith. And I don't want to spend too much time on the inherent meaning of, oh, well, who wants to be weak? I don't want to be weak. I want to be strong. What you had in the Roman church way back when he's writing this is you had, who was the majority? Which ethnic group was the majority, and which ethnic group was the minority? You had Gentiles, which are pretty much all these Romans, Italians, whatever, a lot of metropolitan city. And then you had this minority group, which were Jewish Christians. And what he's saying to those that were in charge, think about a democracy, right? We tend to think the people who are the majority get to make the rules, they get to make the decisions, generally, and they get to decide what's best and to lead the charge. And what Paul was writing, he's looking at these two groups. And in this case, there was a minority group and a majority group. And he says, you guys, basically, who are in the majority, you need to receive these other people that are in the minority and don't argue over differing opinions. We're not talking about what clear scripture says. Again, we have things that are clear. These are things that are secondary. He says, so what he does is he's going to give three examples. One is about eating meat or being a vegetarian. Another one is about observing certain days or festivals or Sabbath day or weekly things. And then later he talks about drinking wine. Now, a Jewish person, scholars will wrestle and say this is most likely a reference to Jewish Christians, because why? Well, a Jewish Christian who comes to Jesus says, yeah, I don't have to follow the Old Testament law, but I want to. Do they have the freedom to follow those laws? Yes. And well, for them, they're a little nervous now, because when they're following these laws, Usually, and even if you go into Judaism today, if you go into a Jewish house, this is in the Bible, but this is the thing that they've added, you have certain plates over here for eating dairy products or anything that would come with a dairy product. You have plates over here, anything that you would eat meat on. You cannot mix them. Okay, that comes from an obscure verse in the Old Testament about boiling a goat in its mother's milk. Like, whoa. Okay, but this is where they come to. So for them, they had these very strict laws. They're called kashrut laws or kosher laws. We know those. But if you're a Jewish person and you go down to the marketplace to buy some meat, you don't know whether it was slaughtered, thank you. Slaughtered according to these very specific rules. So in order to not violate your conscience, you would go, it's better for me just to eat vegetables. Then I don't have to worry about that at all. And they were very good at making extra laws for themselves in order not to violate even at potentially. So you have one group that says, I'm eating vegetables only because in the chance that that piece of meat was not slaughtered right, or maybe it was even offered as a sacrifice to an idol. I don't want anything to do with it. I'm just going to remove all temptation. I'm eating vegetables. Okay? So he says, for one believes, verse 2, that he may eat all things. One person says, I'm not worried about that. I'm going to eat it because I know that there's nothing, I don't have to follow the Old Testament laws anyway, so I'm not even going to eat it. I'm not going to worry about it. One believes he may eat everything, but the one who is weak, in this case the minority position, eats only vegetables. Let not him who eats everything despise him who does not eat. What was happening is, think about it in this, you have one side versus the other side. The guy that is eating everything and he understands that Paul will say later that all foods are clean. We know in Mark 7:19 that all foods are clean, that the Old Testament law has been done away with. Okay, so for that person, they're going, what's the big deal? We don't follow the Old Testament laws anyway. Man, if you were just smart enough and intelligent enough and you were theologically astute enough, you would understand your freedom in Christ. Well, that doesn't sound very nice, does it? He's despising this guy for his lack of something according to his own mind. But the one who is eating only vegetables, let not him who does not eat judge the one who does eat. The one over here is going, well, if you were as spiritual as I am, and you were as sensitive as I am to being obedient to God, you wouldn't take and risk eating a piece of steak that potentially, maybe, possibly was offered to an idol. So if you were as holy as me, you would do what I do. So now you have these two groups. One is condemning the other one, and the other one is judging the other. And Paul's like, okay, that is not the right answer. He says, the one who eats only vegetables and is judging the meat eater, he says, don't judge him, for God has received him. That guy, God, he has not lost out on God's blessings. He has not earned God's disfavor. God has received him just like he has received you. So what happens is you have these, this is super important. Here's the principle. Get anything today is what Paul does here, Paul doesn't weigh in real hard on which side is right. See, often we think in terms of right and wrong. Paul said these are different opinions. There's no right or wrong necessarily here. But what we do is we look at it and we say, well, I've come to this conclusion myself about whatever. And then I start looking over there. And I start going, well, look at their spiritual life. Look at what they're doing. And Paul says, keep your eyes to yourself. That's ultimately where he's going to say, if you want to believe that you only eat vegetables, good for you. Keep your eyes to yourself. Don't you dare look to your brother or your sister whom God has received and start labeling them as whatever. Ignorant, judgmental, not holy. And in the same way, this group over here, he says, you believe you can eat everything? Good for you. Awesome. God has received you. But don't you dare look over there and say, oh, that guy's ignorant. If he only understood the proper theology, and you start despising them. Paul comes right into the middle and says, knock it off. This is not the only one that wins here. It's like going to court. Who's the only one that wins? Lawyers, right? They're the only ones that win. You know, in the full sense. They win all the time. And in the same way, when we come in here and there's this bickering going on, Paul's saying the only one that's losing here is believers. The only one that's winning is the enemy. Because now he's caused this unnecessary division. He says in verse 4, who are you to judge another person's servant? To his own master he stands or falls. Indeed, he will be made to stand, for God is able to make him stand. So right here at the beginning, he just throws it right out there. Who do you think you are to judge that believer when you're not their Lord? They serve Jesus. Jesus is the Lord. They don't answer to you. Why would you, what you're saying is, hey, Jesus, thanks for being their Lord, but I'm going to intervene in here and take your place and usurp your authority over them, and now I'm going to make myself Lord over them. That's pretty harsh. It's pretty direct. Who are you to look at another person's servant? The next example he gives here, he says, well, one person esteems one day above another, but the other person esteems every day the same. Now, think about it from a Jewish perspective. What is the holiest day of the week for a Jewish Christian? Saturday the Sabbath, right? And you got to remember that this is part of their culture for thousands of years, at least 1,500 years, and so it's hard for them to get beyond their traditions. So for them, you work 6 days, Exodus 20, and you rest on the seventh, Saturday. So most of them said, I still like that program. I'm still going to observe it. The other guy says, well, we don't follow the Old Testament law anymore. To me, I'm going to worship God every day. Doesn't that sound spiritual? See, you only worship God Saturday. I worship God every day. See, and if you're only truly as spiritual as me, then, and you're limiting one day, and that's, I do it every day. So you have this arrogance, this pride that creeps in, and we start looking down. And Paul says, hey, that guy thinks one day, this guy thinks every day is the same. Look at verse 5. Let each one be fully convinced in his own mind. You want to observe one day above another? Good for you. Awesome. High five, Paul says. Be fully convinced. That's what God's leading you to do? Awesome. You don't feel that same conviction. You observe every day the same. Be fully convinced. God bless you. These are these gray areas. Again, can we find a verse in the Bible that says you need to observe the Sabbath day? Yes. Exodus 20, again. But that's Old Testament. We're not under, we've been saying all along that we're not under the Mosaic law. We don't throw the Old Testament out, but we understand the limits of the Mosaic system and the 613 commandments. We're under the new system. Nowhere in the New Testament do you ever see the Sabbath day reaffirmed. Do you see adultery? Yes. Do you see lying? Yes. Do you see murder? Yes. Romans 13, right before this, you see those things. Okay? So he goes on. He who observes the day observes it to the Lord. And he who does not observe the day to the Lord, he does not observe it. This is where, in 1 Corinthians 10:31, it says, whatever you do, whether you eat or drink, do to the glory of God, right? So he's assuming here that you are being led by God in your behavior, that you prayed about it and you believe that God is guiding you to observe the day. Awesome. Maybe God is guiding you to observe the day. Maybe God has a reason. Not as a commandment, but maybe he's doing that for a reason. Over here, he's assuming, well, if you don't observe the day, you must be following the Lord's guidance on that. He says each one is doing it for the Lord. They're both fully convinced. He says, he who eats everything eats to the Lord, for he gives God thanks. And he who does not eat meat to the Lord, he does not eat, but he also gives God thanks. For none of us lives to himself, and no one dies to himself. For if we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. Therefore, whether we live or die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and rose and lived again, that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. But why do you judge your brother? Why do you show contempt? Contempt is, what's a synonym for contempt? Let's have a little participation. This is good. Scorn. What's the synonym for scorn? It might be a fancy word. Disgust, condescension, right? And Paul is saying, I mean, the goal here is to check our attitude. Are we looking down? Are we throwing insults or criticisms at some at another brother and sister in Christ in an area that is not explicit? So for example, let's go to your sheet there for a minute. Believers are to be known for their unity. The unity between family, Christian family, means no judging or contempt. Unity also recognizes that we answer to Jesus only. He is Lord. The context here is non-essential issues. What I did, you can see the bold there under lesson 1b, 1 Corinthians 5. Here is a very unique passage in that, think about this. You come to church, and a guy walks in, and he's holding hands with his stepmother. And it's inappropriate. And they're having relations. And you go, ooh, that's really bad, right? That's adultery, very clear. And Paul says, hey, haven't you confronted that? That's pretty serious. Adultery right there? He goes, you guys need to address this situation. And then at the end of chapter 5, in verse 12 and 13, he says, it's your responsibility for a brother or sister to come alongside and to judge them. Is he being contradictory? No, because adultery is clearly wrong. Okay, that's not a gray area. Okay, he's saying to them, you need to hold your brother and sister accountable. You need to love them enough to come alongside and say, hey, you're going to get in trouble here. God's going to be upset. He's going to discipline you. So come alongside and we hold them accountable. In those areas, he has no problem with us doing that. In fact, we should. Okay. But when it comes to the gray areas, the things that are not clearly written in Scripture, he says, who are you to make a judgment against your brother in that non-explicit area? Does that make sense? Right? So we have the distinction. That's what he's talking about. Believers are also to be known for our humility. Humility recognizes that each one should be fully convinced, and it should cause us not to judge or to show contempt. In verse 10, we'll keep moving here quickly. Why do you judge your brother? Why do you show contempt? For we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. We saw in the 1 Corinthians 4 passage that Paul says, man, I don't even judge my motives at times. I know that I'm going to answer to the Lord because he's the one that I'm serving. He'll reveal it into my heart. So I don't even judge anything before the time because I know that each one of us on that day, we're going to come up and we're going to go, all right, Lord, let me know how I did in my Christian walk. This isn't about salvation. Salvation is secured at the cross. But if you become a Christian, God's going to say, what did you do with the time since you became a Christian until now, until the end? What did you do with it? Were you faithful? Did you use your spiritual gifts? Were you obedient? Were you evangelistic? All these other things. How did you live your life after you became a Christian? And we will be getting rewards or discipline, not eternal discipline, that's covered at the cross. That's what he's talking about here. Look at verse 12. So then, each of us shall give an account of himself to God. There's going to be a day where we're going to have to say, yeah, Lord, that was bad. I shouldn't have done that. I'm ashamed of that. Even as a Christian, do you have to show that to me? He says, yeah, it's forgiven. But, okay, should have done better. Yes, Lord, I do know. Therefore, let us not, verse 13, judge one another anymore, but rather resolve this, not to put a stumbling block or a cause to fall in our brother's way. What he says is, specifically about these issues, he switches over and he says, hey, look, the word stumbling block here is a trap. So let's say, for example, you know that your brother or sister, doesn't matter, is very hesitant about eating meat. That they're just, that's their conscience, it binds them. They come over to your house for Sabbath potluck or Sunday potluck, and you whip out a piece of steak in front of them, knowing that that puts them at a conscientious, troublesome situation. Paul says, why would you do that? Yeah, you know that you can eat whatever you want, but why would you deliberately try to trap them? He said, come on, that's not the loving thing to do. That's not the nice thing to do. In fact, it will keep going. So remember that stumbling block. It's a trap. It's an intentional trap. In your arrogance, you would say, well, I'm going to see what they're going to do. And I'm going to teach them that they can eat meat. That's an arrogant perspective. It's one that wants them. It's the opposite of love in 1 Corinthians 13. Love does not seek its own. It looks and says, I want them to believe the way I do, and I'm going to force them to confront the situation, to eat the way I am. Well, that's rude, it's unkind, it's self-serving, all the opposites of what love is. But he says this in verse 14, I know and am convinced by the Lord Jesus that there is nothing unclean of itself. But to him who considers anything to be unclean, to that person it is unclean. It's interesting that Paul weighs in a little bit here to say, hey guys, look, he's writing to the majority. I know that you can eat anything you want. I'm convinced that you can eat anything you want. I'm convinced by the Lord that all food is clean. However, to the person that doesn't feel that way, to him, it is unclean. I mean, imagine you're over here, and they're worried, and they're going, I can't eat it, I just can't. And they are bound up in their conscience. And they say, nope, I'm only going to be a vegetarian because I don't want to offend God. What Paul says to them is, let them be. In their mind, they're convinced. That's earlier, Paul says, let each one be fully convinced. He says, verse 15, yet if your brother is grieved because of your food, you are no longer walking in love. You're trapping him. Do not, this is the key word, underline this. Do not destroy with your food the one for whom Christ died. What Paul says here is, what Paul doesn't do, Paul doesn't try to tell anybody to change their viewpoints. It's fascinating. He just says, hey, look, you have a viewpoint, they have a viewpoint, believe your viewpoint in these areas. I'm not trying to tell you even to change your viewpoint. Keep your viewpoint. But what he says here is, if our action destroys this person, a brother and sister who Jesus died for, if it is at the risk of destroying their entire faith, don't you dare put a trap before them. He elevates it. He didn't tell the guy to stop eating meat. He just said, if you're around him, if it's going to destroy their faith, don't do it. Just restrain your liberty, your freedom. Go eat alone or not around them. It's the same thing. Well, we'll get to it. We'll keep going here. He says, therefore, do not let your good be spoken of as evil. For the kingdom of God is not eating and drinking and mask wearing, you know, let's be honest here, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. There's all this acrimony that's going on in our modern application of this. And Paul's like, I picture God going, these are all so secondary in their importance, that now you have these accusations that are going on. It's about peace. For he who serves Christ in these things is acceptable to God and approved by men. Therefore, let us pursue the things which make for peace and the things by which one may edify one another, build each other up. Do not destroy it, there it is again, the work of God for the sake of food. Now, let's put it in our modern context. Mask wearers on this side, no mask wearers on this side. Okay? The non-mask wearer. If you not wearing a mask is going to destroy the faith of the mask wearer, I mean absolutely obliterate them and remove them from heaven because they're not going to be able to get over the fact that you have a mask, you don't have a mask on. If you were walking around and just strutting, putting your chin out there, see my face, you know. If doing that would put their entire salvation at risk, would you wear a mask? Yes, you would. I know I would. Oh, you're telling me you're going to walk away from Jesus unless I wear a mask? Man, I'm putting three on for you. But is it really that serious? See, Paul is talking about real issues here in the sense of people potentially being destroyed for a lack of following their particular conscience. I don't know if anybody, as far as I know, it says, hey, if you don't wear a mask, I'm going to walk away from Jesus. So we're not even at that level. In the sense, and again, I do think that if it was at that level, every non-mask wearer, when they were around him, would say, for your sake, if it's going to ruin your entire salvation, I'll put one on. But is it that case? Well, no. Okay, well, then I'm going to not wear one. I'm going to keep my own conscience. He says, do not destroy the work of God for the sake of food or masks. All things indeed are pure. Here again, he says, all foods are pure, but it is evil for the man who eats with offense. If you go to trap your brother and you do it intentionally, that's evil. That's wicked. You're putting a trap before them. You're deliberately playing with them. So then he brings up the third one. We had eating vegetables. We had the Sabbath day controversy. Here we have drinking wine. It is good neither to eat meat nor drink wine, nor do anything by which your brother stumbles or is offended or is made weak. Again, if it's going to destroy their faith, it's not worth it. And so you have some, let's say, who were alcoholics. They become Christians now. God has delivered them. But then the temptation is always there. And they know that if they start, man, it's going to really disrupt their spiritual life. And you go, well, hey, I can drink. That's your belief, not mine. So you come over to my house. I'm in my house. I'm going to have a glass of wine in front of you, whether you like it or not. Just deal with it. Is that very kind? Loving? No. Paul said, don't do that. Paul didn't say, hey, you, if you want to enjoy a glass of wine, you need to stop doing it. He doesn't say that. He just says, don't do it when it's going to entrap your brother. He's not telling them to change their viewpoints. He simply says, you need to get along, and you need to be conscientious, that if it's going to destroy your brother's faith, absolutely you wouldn't do that. Why would you do that? He says, it is good neither eat meat nor drink wine or anything by which your brother stumbles or is offended or is made weak. Do you have faith? Do you have faith that you can drink the wine? Do you have faith that you can eat all meats? Do you have faith that you can have every day the same? He said, great. Have it to yourself before God. Keep it between you. He didn't tell him, change your mind. He just said, that's between you and the Lord. That's awesome. If you have faith, great. Keep it between you and the Lord. Happy is he who does not condemn himself and what he approves. He says, man, if you have faith that you can have that glass of wine and it doesn't offend anybody, then you're blessed. You're happy because you're not condemning yourself. But the one who doubts is condemned if he eats, because he does not eat from faith, for whatever is not of faith from faith is sin. This is interesting here because, okay, we believe scripturally in absolute morality, right? Is it wrong in all contexts to murder? Are there any justifications for murder? Like, well, you know, if you believe in eugenics and you want to be Hitler, then I guess it's okay. You know, we look and we go, no, murder's wrong, right? We look at those things and we understand absolute morality. But when it comes to secondary issues or opinions, there's room for disagreement. But what Paul says is, let's say it clearly. This person over here says, man, I can't eat that meat. I'm convinced if I do it, it's gonna be bad. But then, and they're convinced, if I do this, I'm going to sin against God. But that steak smells pretty good. So he goes and he knows in his own conscience that he believes it's wrong. He's convinced himself. But the steak is out there, and it is somehow he walked by, and he goes, oh, I'm sorry, man, I didn't know you were coming, but we have steak for dinner. He's like, yeah, I'll take a bite. And it's good steak. So he takes another bite. The guy whose home is eating the steak, did he sin? No, he can eat anything he wants. The guy who believes it's wrong and does it anyway, did he sin? Yes. It's fast. That's relative morality here. In the gray areas. We're not relativists. When the scripture's clear, lying, murder, adultery, blah, 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 those are wrong under all circumstances, okay? But in gray areas, when it comes to opinion, Paul says the reason why is because they, in their conscience, believed it was wrong and they chose to do it. They deliberately disobeyed their own conscience. And he says, whatever is not of faith is sin. It's a very fascinating thought here. Well, if you're the host, I would say you offend nobody, if you can. But if you had to offend somebody, you would offend the unbeliever. Because why? You know, they're not saved. Believers, we have this special relationship with each other. We need to care for one another. We need to look out for each other. We need to not judge one another. We need to be like, oh, again, if he stopped by the house, I wasn't knowing it, I would probably put it away and go, hey, let's go outside. You know, here you go. I got some carrots for you. You know, or whatever. Let's come outside here. I don't want you to even smell it. Let's go for a walk. I don't want you to be tempted or whatever. In the same way, again, when we're dealing with wine as an example, you don't, somebody comes over, you don't just, and you know they have an issue, you don't just whip out the wine bottle. That's very unloving. It's unkind. You know, again, now if they're not around, fine. Have a drink, but don't get drunk. Get drunk, you've crossed the line. Okay, we know that. That's clear. Tolerance, believers are known for unity, humility, and also tolerance. Tolerance means that we walk in peace and not destruction. Remember, Paul, as he comes into the situation, he doesn't try to say, hey, you need to change your mind, and you need to change your mind, and you need to come to some sort of uniformity in your belief. He said, no, you need to agree to disagree agreeably or lovingly or tolerantly, whatever adverb you want to put on there. That you need to be able to get along in these secondary issues. That you don't entrap your brother. That's very unkind. So for some application here, the majority were condescending and showing scorn. Paul calls them the strong, because whatever that, I'm not going to go there. The minority were self-righteous and were judging. So here they were, both sides, fully convinced in their own mind, but that's good to be fully convinced. But don't look over there. Don't look at that other person and start scorning them, despising them, showing contempt. Start throwing labels. It's interesting here, number three, I want to talk a little about this for a second. I encourage you, as all of us, you need to remove emotion. Emotion is misleading. It can mislead us. Most oftentimes it does. I had shared this with a brother who I care for very dearly, and I said, hey, This is what the scripture teaches about the mask, the non-mask. And the response was, hey, I read your arguments, but I feel. And then he went on. And I was like, I read your arguments, but I'm going to allow my emotion to dictate my response to you. If you've ever had an argument with somebody, can you argue rationally with emotion? No, it doesn't happen. So I didn't even respond. I was like, well, if you're telling me your feelings, who am I to tell you your feelings are wrong? You feel what you feel. But if we want to keep it in the area of dialogue here, I understand you can feel any way you want. But I gave you my scriptural reason for it, to put right in the middle of this controversy, the mask, the no mask controversy. Romans 13, so the next response was, well, all the medical experts are telling us that masks are whatever. So now it was an appeal to authority. Well, that authority says this, and I'm like, well, who's your authority? Well, the CDC. Well, the CDC said in March, don't wear masks. Then the CDC now is saying wear masks. But I have an article from May, recently, peer-reviewed article from the CDC that says masks are absolutely ineffective. And I was like, and I have another, I mean, several articles that speak about the dental saying masks are ineffective. Another article from OSHA saying masks are ineffective. These surgical masks, and if you're wearing a, it's completely ineffective. And I think, who's your authority now? Now we have all these, that authority is contradicting that authority. This authority is contradicting themselves, depending on which day of the year. And I'm like, You can't appeal to authority, unfortunately, when the authority contradicts itself. Now, granted, that is not to say it should change anybody's mind. Believe whatever you want to believe. It's Paul, nor am I, asking anybody to change their viewpoint. What God is asking us to do is to check our attitudes. Believe whatever you want. Be fully convinced, regardless. But don't you dare look over there. Number four, I'll read to you Galatians 5. Because remember, in the book of Galatians, you had those that were wanting to follow the law, said if you don't follow the law, you're a heretic, you're not being biblical. And then you had those who were part of the freedom. And he says this, "For you, brethren, have been called to liberty, to freedom. Only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for the flesh, to put traps, etc. But through love serve one another. For all the law is fulfilled, even in this one word, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. But if you bite and devour one another, beware lest you be consumed by one another." The same battle that he's addressing in Romans, it's human nature, he's addressing in Galatians later. He says, do not allow these issues to cause you to bite and devour one another. "I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh." And then he goes on in Galatians 5 to talk about the lust of the flesh. But the fruit of the Spirit is what? Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. All these wonderful things. He says, look, do not allow these things to cause you to fight and devour. Number five here, what's the pastoral responsibility? I was thinking about this too. One person said to me, well, Mondo, why don't you just ask everybody to wear a mask? And what I had said to this other individual was, look, I'm not here to give you Mondo's opinion. What you would say to me rightfully is, well, what verse do you have, Mondo? Well, I don't have a verse. I'm just appealing to you. And then what does that have? What happens then? Now you have the Mondo followers and the disrespectful, disobedient, obstinate, non-Mondo followers. They're going, well, I follow the pastor. And then I'm going, well, why did I do that? And so I've deliberately kept myself out of it. Why? Because that's what Paul did. It is unwise to, Paul said, I'm not going to get entrenched in these secondary issues. Neither am I. What my job is to be is to protect the freedom of the mask wearers and the freedom of the non-mask wearers, and to encourage them both, don't they dare judge or scorn each other. Amen. Freedom. That's what Paul did. I thought, well, if it's good enough for Paul, it's good enough for me. But yet, what you see in other churches, let them do whatever they want. But I think if the pastor gets involved, he's now taking a stance. And I think it encourages disunity rather than unity. In my opinion, I think we have textual precedent that Paul did not get in the middle. He said, there are some truths here, that's fine. But I'm not going to tell you not, and I'm not going to tell you to. On the bottom here, this is what I hear. If you love others, you'll wear a mask. And if you don't, you're unloving, you're unkind, and you're uncaring. Now, if love is one of the highest virtues of being a Christian, and you call a non-mask wearer unloving, that's one of the worst insults you can throw at a Christian, isn't it? You unloving individual. I have no tolerance for people like you who are unkind and uncaring. Well, that sounds like scorn. Sounds like contempt. Sounds like judging. On the other hand, if you truly loved others, you mask wearer, you wouldn't force your viewpoint on others. You are self-righteous, a fearful sheep who doesn't even follow the science. Both of them are accusing the other of being unloving and unkind. They both have their own righteous reasons in their mind. They're convinced. Paul gets right in the middle and says, knock it off. Love is patient. Are you, as a mask wearer or non-masker, being patient with the other group? If you truly want to be loving, you'll be patient with their ignorance. On one hand, they make an accusation, either side, doesn't matter, of being unloving, but by doing that, they're violating the definition of love itself, which is being patient. This is where Jesus says, hey, you know, you got the 2x4 in your eye, but you're looking at the piece of sawdust in your other brother's eye. Matthew 7. Love does not brag. Love isn't puffed up. Love doesn't go, well, I have the righteous perspective. I have the loving perspective. They don't. Love isn't rude. Well, rude doesn't really throw labels at people. Well, if you were loving, you would do whatever, fill in the blank. It's amazing how that whole house of cards falls right on itself. The very act of throwing an accusation of being unloving, you're being unloving yourself. Love isn't self-serving. It's not easily angered or resentful. One person said, I was extremely angry, me, for not requiring masks. I thought, because it was unloving. I thought, this says here it's easily angered. Now, again, is one side, doesn't matter, I don't care which side, doesn't matter. Do they have resentment to the other? Yes. Love isn't resentful. It's, again, in the very act of being resentful and making an accusation of being unloving, they're violating themselves. It's not glad about injustice, but rejoices in the truth. As we think about, I'll wrap it up here. We know that the world is heading in difficult times, regardless, right? Prophecy. Jesus is coming soon. I don't know when, not next week, I don't know. But we know that the world is shifting in that direction, prophetically. I think it's going to be proven. You know, you can go online and show you things. Jesus makes a comment that the deception, the lawlessness is going to be so severe in the end that if it was possible, even the elect, even the believers that were true would be deceived. And what happens is this principle, how do they get deceived? Because they go beyond what is written. They go and they follow their emotions. They go and they follow something else besides what is written. I thought, this is a great exercise for us as the church to have this debate. Because I picture God going, man, if you can't handle this, a piece of cloth is dividing you? How far have you gone away from this, the word? That when the going gets really tough, you're going to have no chance. If you're biting and devouring each other over this, just think if Satan comes along or the enemy comes along, the world, whatever, comes along and brings something a little bit more potent, we're just going to devour one another. We're not going to tolerate one another. We're going to have no humility. We're going to have no unity or tolerance. That's the message for us. If you want to wear a mask, awesome, wear one. If you don't, awesome, don't wear one. But don't you dare start being resentful or looking over there. If you stand, we'll pray. Father, as we come this morning, we thank you that your word anticipates all these things. Help us to, as believers, to truly be patient with one another, even if we think they're wrong. That we would not be resentful, that we'd not be easily angered. That's the definition of love. Pray, Lord, as well that we would have that unity, that humility, that tolerance. Lord, that we would come and ask ourselves whether we are judging or showing contempt or scorn for that person that disagrees with us. Help us, Lord, to continue to walk with you. As we've been thinking about Galatians, we think about what Jesus did for us on the cross. It's awesome. He died in our place that if we trust him, we can have eternal life. And especially as we see, again, this age, this coming to a close, and we see, especially in our country, things heating up. Help us to stay close to you, to stay close to one another as family, and ultimately to not go beyond what is written. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest.
Thank you guys for worshiping with us this morning. We'll see you next week.